One common argument for economic pessimism stems from the fear of increasing population. Let's take a look at this argument and see if it's true. The Reverend Thomas Robert Malthus published his famous book, An Essay on the Principle of Population, first edition, 1798. This book remains extremely influential today. In the basic argument, Malthus suggests that there are diminishing returns to land. That is, if we add more workers to the land produces smaller and smaller amounts of additional value. This means, for instance, that if population doubles and we imagine twice the number of people working on the land, we don't produce twice as much food. So a doubling of the population would mean that each person actually has less food than before compared to the lower population. Now imagine that a technological improvement comes along and people are somewhat wealthier. In this situation, there will be, according to Malthus, a greater number of people. People will live longer, and they also will have more resources to support a greater number of children. Fewer children, for instance, will die in infancy. That means a growing population. But if you accept Malthus's assumption of diminishing returns to land and the notion of a fixed supply of land, not all is well. The growing population means less food for each person. Over time, the population will shrink again because there will be less food to support children, less food to support people in their old age, and living standards will eventually fall. The basic point is that at first something good happens, then population goes up because of the good news, but in the longer run, that new and larger population brings you back down to a lower standard of living. Those are the basic mechanics of the Malthusian model. Just to review those assumptions written down, there's a fixed and vital factor of production, land. There are diminishing returns on that factor. Income determines population growth. Rising wages mean higher survival rates, but higher survival rates eventually push wages back down. In the Malthusian model, a lot of policies which might appear to help the poor actually don't help the poor at all. For instance, imagine a vaccination program which limits some kind of disease. In the short run, of course, this will make the poor people healthier. But in the Malthusian model, in the longer run, you end up with a greater number of poor people because fewer of them are dying and living standards collapse once again. This seems counterintuitive, and indeed, as we'll see, it's probably false. But nonetheless, this anecdote is one way of thinking through what the Malthusian model would actually mean in practice. There is some evidence that a version of the Malthusian model may help us explain earlier periods in world history. For instance, if we take a typical European living standard during the time of the Roman Empire and compare it to a typical European living standard in, say, the year 1700, it's not clear that there was much progress, if indeed any progress at all. Net sustainable economic growth was slow during virtually all of this period, and many regions of the world retrogressed. We don't have the data to say for sure that Malthus was right about this period, but at the very least, the sense we have from the data we do have is consistent with a Malthusian model. Since the industrial revolutions of the 19th century, the Malthusian model seems to be mostly or even completely false. For instance, take the country of Japan. It really does have a fixed supply of land. Improvements in technology have kept the Japanese standard of living very high, well above subsistence, and rather than just multiplying numbers endlessly, in fact, the birth rate in Japan has fallen dramatically. The population of Japan actually is shrinking, and living standards remain high, even though at the moment the rate of economic growth is fairly low. It's interesting, but in 1800, Malthus himself wrote about China and Japan, and he wrote, I quote, "From the accounts we have in China and Japan, it may be fairly doubted whether the best-directed efforts of human industry could double the produce of these countries even once in any number of years." Of course, what we saw in the late 20th century is that the economic produce of Japan could double in about 10 years' time, and the economic produce of China could double in about 7 years' time and stay there. On these issues, Malthus was quite simply wrong. What about Africa? Might the Malthusian model be true for Africa today? Development economist Charles Kenny set out to study exactly this question, and he looked at data from 46 different African countries. Keep in mind the Malthusian predictions. The first is that rising GDP per capita should lead to a rising population. The second is that a rising population should lead to falling GDP per capita. But of the 46 African countries Kenny looked at, Those Malthusian correlations were found in only 13 of them, and only in 4 of those 13 cases were the correlations even marginally strong, defined by Kenny as greater than 0.3. That suggests that for the most part, even for Africa, the Malthusian model today is false. The Malthusian model is perhaps best thought of as a kind of challenge which the world must face, but not as a good description of how the world actually works, at least not today. For further readings on this topic, you can Google Thomas Robert Malthus. You can even read Malthus's essay online if you want. And for the more modern take, using data, please Google Charles Kenny Malthusian Trap.